Dodgers. Now Gold Glove Award winner, Wes Parker.
Thank you for coming. Both Andy and I realize you had other choices, as they say in the airline industry, like watching the lunar eclipse, or for some of you students studying in your dorm rooms. We're glad you picked us over the studying. You're all Dodger fans, I can see by what you're wearing. Let me just fill you in a little on my background. I grew up in LA on the west side in Brentwood. And for those of you who don't know, Andy didn't mention it, but before the Dodgers came to LA, we had two minor league teams here in this city, the Angels and the Hollywood Stars. And they're both in the old Pacific Coast League. They both played a beautiful brand of baseball. Baseball at that time was classified anywhere from D, which was the lowest minor league, up through C, B, A, double A, triple A. And the Pacific Coast League was so good that it was actually classified open classification, which meant it was between triple A and major league level, because many of the guys that wound up being in the big leagues played here in LA before the Dodgers came, either with the Stars or the Angels. For instance, Billy Mazeroski, who's in the Hall of Fame, played for Pittsburgh. He played for the Hollywood Stars. And as a kid, my dad took me out to watch him play. Dick Stewart, who played first base for the Pirates later. And I played with him with the Dodgers in 1966. He played for the Hollywood Stars. These were two of my heroes as a kid. So we had a very good brand of baseball going on in LA, and we had passionate fans. And I can tell you one of the neatest experiences of going to a game at Gilmore Field, where the Hollywood Stars played, which is now where the Grove is in Farmers Market, was if it was a sellout. Because then what they would do with the overflow crowd, instead of turning them away, they said, okay, you can stand in the outfield. We'll put a rope out there and you just stand behind the rope. You can sit on the grass. You can be 10 feet from the left fielder or 10 feet from the center fielder or the right fielder, and you can experience the game up close and personal. They don't do that anymore. They stopped doing it. You can't do that at the major league level. I don't even think they do it in the minor leagues anymore, because lawsuits. If somebody got hit by a line drive, they'd sue the team. So they stopped doing that. But that was a fantastic experience for kids in 1957 and earlier, before the Dodgers came in 1958. And how many of you know that when the Dodgers were on their way here and we knew they were coming, I think it was the LA Times and Herald, maybe both, and you may not even know this, but they had a contest among fans to pick a new nickname for the Dodgers. Did you know that? Most people don't remember that. How many people knew that? I can't believe it. They actually had a contest and people were sending in names, I don't know what, I can't remember what the other, what some of the offerings were, but finally, nothing was good enough and they just decided to keep the name Dodgers, which is so good. And those of you who are real Dodger fans know that that name came from the old Brooklyn days, before they had cars, when they had trolleys running, and people were in Brooklyn were dodging trolley cars. So they called them the Brooklyn Trolley Dodgers, and then shortened it to Brooklyn Dodgers. It's a great history. The Dodgers were never a winning ball club until 1941, when they started getting some pizzazz, and they had Leo DeRocher, and Pee Wee came up in his rookie year, and then starting in 1947 with Jackie Robinson, they won consistently. And after Jackie in 48, then Gil came up, and Duke Snyder, and Roy Campanella, and breaking the color barrier, Don Newcomb came up with Roy Campanella. And by the time they got here in 1958, they were a winning franchise. And this city went gaga for them. The only people that were a little upset were some like me who loved the Hollywood Stars so much that we didn't want to see them leave. Because Gilmore Field was a 12,000 seat stadium, very intimate. You were, I think if you were in the first, the field seats right opposite first or third base, you were 15 feet from the foul line, 15 feet. The Dodger Stadium, I think behind home plate is maybe 60, something like that. So it was a very intimate experience. You were close to the players. It was a very friendly experience. You can still have that same kind of experience if you go out to a game in, let's say, Rancho Cucamonga, where the Dodgers have their A farm club. And you'll get that minor league feel where they have entertainment in between innings. They have kids circling with their foreheads on a bat and then trying to run first base from home plate. When they're dizzy and they fall down, or they dress up in clown outfits and or have a throwing contest, or at the end of the game they all try and throw tennis balls into a hoop, and if your ball lands in the hoop and they're all numbered and it's your number, you win $500 or something like that. But and then they had throwing contests. Some of the players would try to throw the ball in a basket at second base. Or Carlos Bernier was one, or the Cuban Comet they called him, who played for Hollywood. They'd have him circle the bases and try and do it in less than 13 seconds. Something like that, and then do it against one of the Angel players because they're both in this same city and they were bitter rivals, so they have a star running against an Angel going around the bases. And I tell you, it was magical, folks, especially for kids before the Dodgers came. Now, I got over my sadness about the Hollywood Stars relocating to Salt Lake City the second game that my father took me to, second Dodger game, because he got season tickets. And the brand of baseball was suddenly a whole level higher. Even I, as a high school kid, could tell the difference that, wow, these guys are really good. And I'm sure you remember they played in the Coliseum the first 4 years while Dodger Stadium was being built. And the first year, 1958, guess where the Dodgers finished after coming from all those great seasons in Brooklyn? Next to last. And I remember going, my dad took me to the spring kickoff banquet for 1959, for the 1950 season. The sports writers used to put on this banquet every year to kick off the season for the Dodgers. And I remember, I think it was Milton Berle or somebody got up, and he was the master of ceremonies, and he said, the big question this year is, can the Dodgers this year finish ahead of the Phillies again? And they went from next to last, which was seventh place in 1958, to winning the pennant and the World Series in 1959, which was remarkable. And one of the heroes of that, the playoff, it was the Dodgers tied for the pennant and had a playoff with Milwaukee. And back in Milwaukee, they were losing in a windstorm about to rain, but Johnny Roseboro came up and hit a three-run homer to win that game. And then they clinched it here in L.A., and that's when Vin Scully, the greatest baseball announcer that ever lived, without a doubt, said, and we go to Chicago. And they went to Chicago and beat the White Sox. Now, here I am, a kid who grew up on the west side of L.A. as a Hollywood Star fan, then a Dodger fan, and I signed with the Dodgers the winter of 1962, before the draft. I knew Chuck Dressen was a coach on the team. I called him up and I said, I want to play for the Dodgers, and he laughed. He said, doesn't work that way, kid. It doesn't work that way. We call you, you don't call us. And I said, give me a tryout, and they did. And I played winter ball here in 62. This is after I graduated from Claremont. Played against Whittier College, they always beat us. And I love baseball, and I love the Dodgers, and I went to spring training in 63 with the Dodgers and played in the minor leagues. Came up in 64 and 65 and won a world championship, 65. So I was a huge fan of the Dodgers, especially after joining the team, and we had great guys. I always loved first baseman Ernie Banks, who just passed away. Bill White, who became president of the National League, he was the first baseman for the Cardinals and the 64 world champions. Willie McCovey of the Giants. Richie Allen, who I played with in 1971 and was the first baseman for the Phillies and the Cardinals for a while. These were some of the finest men I've ever met in my life. You know, people always ask, well, what do you talk about at first base? We just say things like, God, your guy's throwing good tonight, or how does anybody ever hit this guy, or how are you doing, or what's going on, or who do you think's going to win the pennant, or what's going on in your life? But just little things like that. And I told some of the people out in front before we started this meeting that Roberto Clemente was my favorite player, and he was. These guys were such fabulous people, the Major League Baseball players. And let me tell you, too, that I know some of you have bad impressions of Walter O'Malley. I like to stay out of politics. I was a ball player. It's a lot simpler being a ball player than to get involved in the political arena. And he treated me beautifully. He treated me beautifully. So did Peter. They were wonderful to us as players. And I want to tell you, their philosophy was, we want to do everything for you so that your life is uncomplicated during the season, as uncomplicated as possible, so that when you walk out on that field, you have only one thing to think about, and that is winning, giving your best, playing the best that you can. Now, how good was it? I'm going to tell you. When we never went through an airport. We had our own airplane. The O'Malleys owned their own airplane. At first, it was an electric jet like the one that you put up on the screen. But because it was headwinds going from the East Coast to the West Coast, it took 7.5 hours of a fuel stop in Nebraska, Grand Island. And we complained about that. So Walter finally went ahead and bought a 4-engine jet. I don't know if it was 707 or what, 747, whatever it was. It had 4 engines and it was fast. And we could make that trip quite easily. And he gutted the entire interior of the plane. Every seat front to back was first class seating. About every 6 seats was partitioned off so you could play cards, sleep, reporters could type up their stories if they wanted to. Noby Kawano would be our stewardess. He was our clubhouse guy, and he would serve the meals, and we always ate well. We never went through an airport lobby, folks. A game would end in Chicago. We'd get on a bus from Wrigley Field, go to O'Hare Airport. The bus would park on the tarmac, 10 feet from the steps leading onto our airplane. We'd get off the bus, walk 10 feet, walk up the steps of the plane, sit down. They'd pull up the steps. We never had a delay. Go right to the head of the line and take off for New York, San Francisco, Pittsburgh, whatever it was. Our uniforms were always washed and cleaned after games. Our spikes were cleaned of dirt. We'd finish the game, go home, come back the next day. All of our uniform gear was hung perfectly in our lockers. Spikes were polished, clean, ready to go. In hotels, we never had to check in or out of a hotel. We walked into the lobby. The traveling secretary, Lee Scott, said, "Wes, here's your room key." We'd go up to the room. The luggage would appear 5 minutes later. When we checked out, we'd come down and hand the key to our room, to the front desk person, go out, get on the bus, go to the airport, or go to the ballpark. We never had to do anything. I've been through the jet, Air Force One, that is in the Ronald Reagan Museum in Simi Valley. Simi, that airplane, Air Force One. So help me God, I'm speaking from experience. I walked through that jet. Our plane, our Dodger plane, was better than that. So I'm an O'Malley fan. I'm a Peter O'Malley fan. I know all of the wonderful things these two men have done for charity, how they've taken care of ball players, teammates, Dodger players, teammates of mine who got into financial trouble or drinking, had drinking problems or drug problems or whatever it might be. And these two men helped my teammates, people that you rooted for and cried for and prayed for, he helped them out of some really dark holes. So if you don't like the O'Malleys for certain things that they might have done, understand that behind the scenes and for the players themselves, they did some beautiful, wonderful things for us that helped us to be winners on the field of play, which we were. And the camaraderie and the chemistry that we had was something special. And in the meeting that I had with some of you fans out there before this one, I told you it's so important to have that kind of team spirit, team camaraderie, team chemistry, because that's what really leads to winning. Talent, yes, is important, but you can have all the talent in the world, and if guys don't get along together, if they don't share time together, if they don't like each other, it's awfully hard to win that way. And the Dodgers are, I think, fighting somewhat of an uphill battle. They're going to win the division. When it gets to the playoffs, we're going to see what they're really made of. Because then they're going to be up against teams who are talent-wise just as good as they are. And it's going to come down to little stuff, like how much do you love a teammate and how well do you know his movements and do you trust him to throw a ball and start a double play without looking, because you've got to get rid of the ball so fast you don't have time to look. You just wind up and fire. We're going to have to see if this money that all these guys are getting paid has eroded some of their desire to compete. And I'm getting into dangerous waters right now. I understand that. I know a lot of people, especially in the Dodger organization, wouldn't want to hear this stuff. But I'm just previewing what you're going to be seeing. This is Sunday night, so the playoffs are going to start not next week, but the week after. The Dodgers will be in it. They're going to be playing the Mets or Pittsburgh, I think, probably. It's not going to be a walkover, folks. It's going to be tough. It's going to be really tough. And you remember last year with St. Louis, those games could have gone either way. We lost some games we could have won. We really could have won. And it's going to come down to those critical moments that we're going to see just how much heart this Dodger team has. Okay, we're all going to find out just exactly what they're made of. I loved the 9 years I spent in the major leagues. I made some fantastic friends. My favorite player, as many of you know, was Roberto Clemente. Who's as good a ball player as I ever saw. Everybody said, wait a minute, Willie Mays. I went, check the stats out. Willie Mays was better in the 50s, early in his career. Clemente was better in the 60s, later in his career. The last 9 years Clemente played, he hit over 300 eight times. The last 9 years of Mays' career, he hit over 300 zero times. I know, hard to believe, but it's true. Clemente was one heck of a baseball player, along with Willie Mays, and Frank Robinson, Johnny Bench, Pete Rose. Does Pete Rose belong in the Hall of Fame? Of course, on his talent, on his hustle, on his desire, on his skills, absolutely. The only thing that's holding him back is you can't lie to a commissioner about whether you've been on baseball. You can't do that. You can't insist that you didn't gamble and bet, and then 20 years later, after you've thrown all your friends on the bus who supported you, come out and say, yeah, I did do it. I mean, Pete's been vacillating back and forth. This is a great country, I don't have to tell you that. If you come out and say, yeah, I screwed up, I made a mistake, people are going to forgive you. Pete didn't do that, and Pete's a good guy. He's a good guy, I know him, I played my whole career against him. Admire the heck out of him. But you know what happens when you get to be as big as Pete Rose, you think you're bulletproof, you think you're above the law, basically. And I think he thought he could get away with it, he found out he couldn't. So rather than try and guess what else you might want to hear from me, I think I'd like to take some questions now. But before I do that, I do want to thank the students that are here tonight, because I think it's wonderful that you came. I really do. Whether you like baseball or not, I assume that you do, but even if you don't, this is such a marvelous game, this game of baseball. And unless you play it or really study it, you don't understand how cerebral a game baseball is. It's a real thinking man's game. I know when I first came up to the big leagues, I thought, well, all you do is a hitter. The secret to hitting, just see the pitch and swing at it. There's so much more to that. There's so much more. You have to know the pitcher. You have to know his tendencies. You have to know what pitches he throws, how they break, how hard he throws, when he throws his curveball, when he throws his fastball, what is his out pitch, What is the pitch he's going to throw you when he absolutely has to get you out? Because that's going to be different than the pitch he's going to throw you when he doesn't care if you get a hit because you can't hurt him. There's so much of that positioning in the infield. Should you play deep? Should you play closer to the line? Should you play in the hole? Should you play up close because the guy runs fast? And this is, I'm just scratching the surface, people. I'm just giving you a little brief idea here of how cerebral the game of baseball is. And like I said, unless you play it or study the heck out of it, you cannot possibly know. You can't appreciate it. And I played all through college, Little League, Pony League, American Legion ball, high school, winter ball, everything. And I had no idea until I hit the big leagues. No idea. And I also want to say there's a teammate here. God bless him. He came out to be here tonight to say hello to me. I played with him at Albuquerque before I came up to the Dodgers when I was in the minor leagues in Double A. Ernie Rodriguez. So Ernie, please stand up and just let people say hello to you. Thanks, Ernie. Thanks for coming. Ernie's one of those guys who's just, you can see a smile just talking about him. I mean, he's just one of the heart and soul good guys and salt of the earth. And Ernie, I love playing with you. And God bless you for coming. Thank you. I think more maybe than most for me, it was a lack of confidence, not being sure that I had the kind of resolve, let's call it, to compete with guys who grew up in many cases in cutting sugar cane, or I know Jim Brewer and Wally Moon both told me they never had a pair of shoes until they were 14 years old. And I've been raised in a wealthy family. My mom had a lot of money. My dad was a successful businessman. And we had housekeepers, we had gardeners, we had a 2.5 acre estate in Brentwood on the west side of LA. I went to private schools. And all of a sudden, I'm competing with guys who are from the streets, basically. And it was an adjustment. Let me tell you, it was either sink or swim. I mean, I had to learn very quickly. These guys didn't care about my background one bit. All they cared about was, can you play this game? Can you get the job done? And that's one thing. That by the time you hit the big leagues, there are no longer any excuses. You can't say, well, you know, I don't feel so good today, or I've got a headache, or I had a fight with my wife, or my girlfriend left me, or I think I've got a sore heel, or my neck is stiff because the air conditioning last night, you know, I'm not sure I can look at the picture, I may have to turn this way. Forget all of that. Doesn't matter. Nobody cares. Nobody cares, especially the guys on your team. I remember Ron Fairley coming up to me many times before big games. Ron Fairley was from Long Beach Poly, kind of a middle-class kid and tough. He was rough. And he went to SC. He played for Rod Dato, but Ron was a fierce competitor. And he'd come up to me, and he'd stand right in front of me before a big game. He'd look me right in the eye, and he'd go, Are you ready to play today? I went, yeah, now I am. I mean, I was kind of easygoing, you know, kind of a shy kid, and all of a sudden, I'm in the big leagues, and I had to gear up everything. I had to have more energy, I had to have more concentration, I had to have more focus, I had to have more of everything that it takes to be successful at the big league level. So yeah. You hit a nerve there. That's definitely it. I don't know what they mean, but I will tell you this. Let's say a left-hand pitcher's in his windup. Okay, I'm the hitter. I know his release point is going to be, let's say, right here. Okay. So everybody used to say, "Oh, Juan Marsh, oh my God, that high leg kick. How can you possibly hit that guy? Because you're going to be watching his leg." No. You don't watch his leg. You don't watch his glove, you don't watch anything. If a left-hand pitcher started his windup, I'm not looking at that. I'm looking at this little space of air right here, about a 6-inch square. Because after all of this stuff is over, and look at Tim, I'm turning it down. After all that stuff is over, guess what? He has to his arm has to come right there into that square of air, right there. So I'm glued to this spot because that's where the ball's coming out of, is right there. And that's why that's how I learned to pick up pitches instantly. I mean instantly. Bob Gibson would release a pitch and I would see it the moment it was 6 inches out of his hand, and I'd start reading it. You read pitches by the way the ball spins. If the ball's spinning this way, it's an overhand curveball. If it's spinning this way, like counterclockwise, it's a rising fastball. If it's spinning sideways, it's a flat curve. If you see a little red dot on the ball because a slider will spin around a portion of the seam, you know it's a slider. And if it's just floating in like that, it's a knuckleball. So that's the secret. As for my drug work, 1971 and 72, Jimmy Lefebvre and I, along with Dave Hull, the Hullabalooer, who was the rock DJ for KRLA and then had a show on KFI, the Dodger station, the three of us went out and gave drug talks to local schools, starting in high schools, and then we stopped with the high schools because they know everything. You know, I remember we'd go to high schools, the first person to raise their hand would say, "What do you know about drugs? You ever taken drugs?" We'd go, "Well, we don't think you have to know drugs will kill you. It seems pretty obvious. Like, do you have to jump off a 20-story building and know you'd be dead when you hit the ground?" That's basically what we were. That's how we would argue with the kids, but we didn't want to argue with the kids. We wanted kids to trust us. So we started going to junior high schools and grade schools. And then the kids were far more receptive. But my attitude was, and Jimmy's and Dave's as well, was we'd all been lucky. I had good lives, even then when I was just 30. It was already a good life. That we wanted to give something back, and drugs was a big problem in the late 60s, early 70s. So we dedicated ourselves to trying to help kids stay off of drugs. Story. The Sandy Koufax's perfect game, September 9th, 1965, right? But who's counting? Well, first of all, and I've done a lot of interviews because people are calling wanting to hear about all that. But first of all, every time Sandy took the mound, I expected him to pitch a no-hitter. He was that good. I didn't even realize he had a perfect game going until maybe the sixth inning. And you'll like this story. He still had it going after seven innings, so now Jimmy Lefebvre, the second baseman, who was a rookie that year, 65, and I was a first-year starter at first base, my second year, but first year as a starter, so we run in together, we sit on the bench, bottom of the seventh inning, and I look at Jimmy, he looks at me, and I say, "Jimmy, I sure hope nobody hits the ball to me." I don't want to screw up this perfect game. And Jimmy said, "Neither do I." And as it turned out, we could have stayed in the dugout because Sandy struck out the side in the eighth and then struck out the side in the ninth. Struck out the last six guys. The 2-2 pitch to Harvey Keene swung on and missed. A perfect game. Can't stop. Right? You've all heard that. Yes, I was the Dodger player rep in 71-72. In 72, the players had their first strike where we actually started to miss games. And if you remember, I was the only player who voted against the strike. And Jim Murray wrote a big article about it saying, well, you know, Wes is from wealthy background, so of course he's going to take the owner's position. That wasn't it at all. That wasn't my thinking. I was just so darn grateful to the Dodgers that they gave me the chance to play Major League Baseball because no scouts offered me a contract. None. I hit 500 in high school my senior year. At Claremont College, I was All-American my junior year. All-American, small college. Hit 400 three straight years. You know how many scouts came and talked to me? Zero. Zero, not one. I wound up a major leaguer because I already told you the story. In 62, I called Chuck Dressman and said, "Please give me a tryout. I want to play for the Dodgers." So now I'm the Dodger player up in 72. This is my ninth big league season, and the guys on the team are all saying, "Let's strike." for more retirement benefits. And I didn't even run for the office. They nominated me and voted me before I could even say, I don't want it. So here I am, the Dodger player rep, and now everybody wants to strike. And I said, no. No, I wouldn't even be here if it wasn't for Peter and Walter O'Malley. Wouldn't even be here. I am not going to strike against the people that gave me a chance to play this game. That was my attitude. I would agree Marvin Miller should be in the Hall of Fame. And then as far as players go, the four most egregious omissions, I would say, would be Maury Wills. Gil Hodges. Gil Hodges, look at his numbers, folks. Look at Gil Hodges. Gil was one of my heroes, too. He's the Dodger first baseman before me, basically. He had over 100 RBIs, I think, seven straight years. He was the manager of the Mets when they won the World Series in 69. He won the first three Gold Gloves. I mean, I think he should be in. The argument I hear is, well, there's so many of those Brooklyn guys in already, they don't want to put another one in. But, and also I've heard the argument, well, he never led the league in anything, but you don't have to lead the league to be a great player. You talk to I used to talk to Duke Snyder about him, and Pee Wee, and some of those guys, Jackie, and they loved Gil. He was the rock of the infield. The other one I would mention, oh boy, was this guy a good ball player, Tony Oliva.
Yeah.
Tony Oliva. He was Rod Carew, who's in the Hall of Fame, with power. With power. He could do everything Rod Carew would do, could do, but he had power. He should definitely be in. Dick Stewart. Dick Stewart had a minor league record, I think in 56, where he hit like 60 home runs or something, 50 some home runs. Then he comes to Hollywood Stars in 57, and first time up, it's a home run. And then he goes to Pittsburgh and hits home runs. He goes to Boston and hits home runs. And then we make a trade for him in 66. He comes to the Dodgers. So, oh, what was the funny story? Oh, God. Dick was telling us stories in the dugout about, because he didn't start. I was starting. And that used to annoy him, too. He'd go, how can Alston start you over me at first base? So then he said, he was telling us all, you know, I got this guy's in my book, the guy that's pitching. I got him in Cincinnati in 1958 with two out over the left center field wall, ball went 450 feet. He's telling us all these stories about every home run he's ever hit. And Jimmy LaFever said, Dick, tell us about your feeling. And Dick was nicknamed Dr. Strange Glove because he made so many errors. And he said, let me tell you about that. He said, one time I got a standing ovation for my fielding. We were playing in Boston, the wind was blowing, and a hot dog wrapper was blowing by, and I backhanded it. And the people in Boston gave me a standing ovation for backhanding the hot dog wrapper. That's a true story. Well, Chuck Dressen, who was the Dodger manager in 51, 2, 3, something like that, and got fired because he wanted more than a one-year contract, and that's when Walt Alston became the manager in 54. But anyway, Dressen wound up as a friend of my dad's. He lived in L.A., and my dad met him socially. So my father, this is 1951, and my dad said, why don't you come out and watch my kid play Little League Baseball, which I did in West L.A. Field is still there, right off of the 405 freeway, Wilshire and Sepulveda. Chuck came out and watched me play, and my dad asked him for an autographed picture. So Chuck wrote, 1951, I'm just a Little League kid, I'm 11 years old. And Chuck wrote on this picture of himself to Wes Parker, and I used to pitch, he said, a grand little pitcher, maybe a Dodger someday, signed Chuck Dressen. And 13 years later, I was playing for the Dodgers. Is that what you mean? Yeah, true. That's true.
And you still have it?
I still have it, yes. Yeah, you can't make this stuff up. I mean, you've got to understand that my having a career with the Dodgers was borderline miracle, truly borderline miracle. Nobody comes from wealth and plays Major League Baseball. Just doesn't happen. Nobody does that. Maybe a pitcher like Jim Palmer, he came out of Beverly Hills. But pitching's different. You can be supremely talented and go out there every fifth day and be great, but try going out and playing every single day. Every single day as a regular player. And going up against, in the 60s, going up against, I counted 15 Hall of Fame pitchers. 15 Hall of Fame pitchers. Every team in the National League had two guys that wound up on the Hall of Fame, like the Mets had Nolan Ryan and Tom Seaver. And the Cardinals had Bob Gibson and Steve Carlton. And the Atlanta Braves had Phil Niekro and Hoyt Wilhelm. And the Giants had Gaylord Perry and Juan Marichal. And we had Koufax, Drysdale, and Sutton. I mean, it was unbelievable. And plus, the mound was higher. Plus, the stadiums were bigger. Or Dodger Stadium certainly wasn't. They didn't cut the grass. The grass was about 2 inches long. You'd hit a bullet into the grass in the infield, in the hole, and the grass would slow it down. The shortstop would go over and pick it up barehanded and throw you out. I mean, it was really hard. So then suddenly they cut the grass, they moved the fences in. Some of the Hall of Fame pitchers retired. I learned more about how to hit, and lo and behold, 1970 comes along, and I hit 319 after hitting 238 in our World Championship year. So it's a learning process, and to getting back to your question was, yeah, for a while I was hanging on by my fingernails. Remember the picture of the cat hanging on by its claws? It takes a while. Hitting big league pitching, folks, let me tell you, it is not easy. It is no picnic. And you don't have to do it. You're not required to go out there and just do it once or twice. You have to go out there and do it every single night for 6 months. 6 months. With 50,000 people watching and Vin Scully calling every pitch. I mean, you can embarrass yourself very quickly. So, and I'm not saying this to trumpet myself. I'm really saying this so that you will appreciate how hard this game is and how great Clemente and Mantle and Frank Robinson and Johnny Bench and Pete Rose and Lou Brock and even a guy like Bill White, who's borderline Hall of Famer, or Kenny Boyer. There's another borderline Hall of Famer. And, you know, Ron Sandler just got in. But if you ask anybody from my generation, if you had a choice between Kenny Boyer and Ron Sandler at third base, who would you pick? Every one of us would pick Kenny Boyer. Every one of us. So is the Hall of Fame fair? No. Hall of Fame isn't fair. Is the Academy Award fair every year? How about the year Liz Taylor should have won for Cat on a Hot Tin Roof? But she took Debbie Reynolds, she took Eddie Fisher away from Debbie Reynolds. So let's not give it to her, and they didn't. And then she had a tracheotomy the next year and won it for Sunlight Last Summer or something, some ridiculous movie. Life isn't fair. So, and I learned that, that's part of what I learned. Baseball is pretty doggone fair. You know, 2-for-4 is good, 0-for-4 is bad. That's pretty simple to figure out. But you learn, once you learn what the rules are and how tough it is, then at least you feel like you have a fighting chance. Once you take the politics out of it, you feel like you have a fighting chance.
Yes.
I hadn't started yet in 62. I love that 62 team. They're heartbreaking, the way they lost. They had a 6-42 lead in the top of the ninth in the third game of a playoff with the Giants. And Matty Alou led it off with a bunt single. I remember that. And then somebody moved Larry Burr right out of double play position. And it's always been a question as to who did it, because Harvey Keene hit a one hopper right at him. It should have been a double play. They only got one out because Burwright was out of position. The one hopper went to Wills, sorry. But it took Burwright so long to get over to second base to get the throw that the relay to first was late. And then the Giants went on and scored 4 runs. That's when Stan Williams walked a Giant with the bases loaded to force him to go ahead and run, with Don Drysdale warming up in the bullpen. And they asked Alston later, why didn't you bring in Don Drysdale to get the Giants out? And he said, we were saving him for one game, game one of the World Series. Wrong answer. Wrong answer. You know, Duke Snider went to Drysdale in the bottom of the eighth and said, get your ass down to the bullpen. I hope I didn't offend anybody. Ladies. He said, you get down to the bullpen. He said, I've seen this before. He said, I went through the same thing in 1951. And there was Drysdale ready to go. He won the Cy Young Award that year, folks. He won 25 games. And Alston never used him. But Alston was a great manager. Now, it's for 71. The amazing thing about that was the Giants jumped off to a 10-game lead. Mid-May, they were ahead of us by 10 games. And we started eating into their lead. And the last eight times we played them in August and September, we beat them eight straight. And yet they won the pennant by one game because we couldn't quite make up the deficit. And I think we won our last couple of games, but so did they, so we couldn't catch them. That was a good club. Bill Buckner had just come up. And incidentally, a trivia question, who replaced me at first base? It was Bill Buckner. And Buckner was a really good hitter, and he got a bad rap missing that ground ball in the World Series, against the Mets. He really got a bad rap. Bill's a great guy. I love Bill Buckner. God, he's hard-nosed and tough and a terrific player and loves to compete. He was never a great fielder. He didn't have that gift, but he was hustling. He made a point, and I believe him. I think he's right. When you break in a glove, especially first baseman's glove, because it's longer than most, it can tend to get a little floppy like this if you break it in incorrectly or use it too long. So if you jerk your hand one way or the other, the glove will flop over. And if you bring your hand back this way, the glove will flop back there before it comes back. And he moved his hand so quickly to catch a kind of an in-between hop that the glove actually was late getting in front of the ball. But that's his fault for having that kind of a glove. He didn't break that glove in properly. The way you break in the glove is you want it firm on the exterior and soft in the middle. Firm on the exterior so that it won't flop around like that. Soft in the middle so that balls will stick in there. How was I feeling at the time? Nervous. Here's the situation. This is 1968. Drysdale was on his way to breaking the consecutive scoreless inning streak that Walter Johnson had set way back in the 1920s. We're playing the Giants. We had the bases loaded with nobody out. In the top of the ninth, and we had it was 2-0 lead. I think it was either 2 or 3-0. And Dick Dietz was the hitter. A 2-2 pitch inside from Drysdale, and Dick just did this, and the ball hit him in the arm. It looked like the streak was over. He was going to get first base, and a run would be forced in. Harry Wendelstedt, the home plate umpire, said, no, hold that, hold everything. You made no attempt to get out of the way of the pitch. Therefore, you do not get the base. It's only ball three. So 20 minutes of arguing. Herman Franks, everybody arguing about it. The Giants going crazy like they always did. Then Dietz fouls off a couple of pitches, hits a little fly ball to shallow left field to Jim Ferry. There's a name way out of the past. And they don't tag up, so now there's one out. Giants still have the bases loaded. Ty Klein pinch hits, left-hand hitter. I was playing about even with the bag. Now this is one of those situations, remember I talked about this is a cerebral game? And I'm thinking, okay, if the ball's hit to my right hard, I can go for a second first double play. If the ball's hit to my left hard, I'm going home because I'm not sure we can get a second to first double play because the throw is longer, that'd take more time. If the ball's hit right at me hard, I have an option. I can go second to first double play or I can go home to first double play. If the ball's hit at me softly, I'm going home, period. Because I want to prevent the run from scoring to help Don Drysdale. Ty Klein hit a one hopper right at me, chest high. I might have gone to second, but I went, maybe they won't turn it fast enough and Klein will beat out the return throw. So I threw home. force out to Jeff Torborg. Now there's two outs. Now Jack Hyatt pinch hits for the Giants. God, I hated the Giants back then. Especially Tito Fuentes. I liked Willie Mays, but anyway. So here's Jack Hyatt. First pitch, he gets a little pop up over my head. And Vince Scully, remember everybody brought transistor radios to the ballpark? So I'm right under the ball, it's right above my head. I don't even have to move. But I hear Vince Scully and all the transistor radios going, he's 60 feet from the record. Don't drop the ball, Wes. Don't drop the ball. I caught it. That was the end of it. And I gave the ball to Don. Incidentally, if you were to ask me who was the player on the Dodger Ball Club of the 60s who everybody looked up to, who everybody admired, who was basically the leader, the spiritual leader of your team, it is unquestionably Don Drysdale. Unquestionable. Not Sandy Koufax, not Maury Wills, not Tommy Davis, not Ron Fairley, Don Drysdale. He was one heck of a guy. I really feel privileged just to have been around that guy and known him. Loved him. Great competitor, great guy, terrific sense of humor. Just one of the best. And you people who are such Dodger fans, especially back then, be proud. Really, you can be proud because you rooted for guys who you would have been proud to have in your home. I mean it. Some of the finest men I've ever met. God bless them all. All right.